Did Arby's write a contemporary Shakespearean sonnet? Let's take a look at the cup. Sure, it may start with the promise of a perfect sandwich, but for us, it goes beyond that. It's a matter of pride. It's our commitment to serve, refresh, and delight every guest so they have a truly delicious experience. That's who we are. That's what we do. If your food or experience did not delight, we would be happy to make it right. Now you may be thinking to yourself, how in the world is this a sonnet, let alone anything that could possibly be called poetry? Nothing rhymes except the last couple of lines. Now granted, this is true. But in a world where art embraces minimalism now more than ever, and where poetry is expressively, not exclusively, excessively flexible, adhering to a certain rhyme scheme seems rather blasé. Rhyme is the least important of qualifications for a contemporary sonnet. Now what is a sonnet? In its simplest definition, a sonnet is a poem consisting of usually 14 lines that normally does have some rhyme scheme, and is most famously written in iambic pentameter. Beginning with Petrarch in 13th century Italy, the sonnet was most often split into an octave detailing a problem, and concluding with a sestet offering a solution to that problem. The turn from the end of the octave and going into the sestet was called just that in Italian, la volta. It was at this moment in the sonnet that there was a switch in mood, a turning from one ideology to another. Fast forward 3 centuries and hop across the Atlantic to England. Queen Elizabeth I sits the throne, and many of her poets have taken a new approach to their predecessor's form. The Elizabethan sonnet, or the Shakespearean sonnet, eponymous for the man who most notably wrote in the form, styled itself in a series of 3 quatrains and concluded with a couplet. It still included a volta, but now it emphasized an inclusion of the self in the world, an ideology that would crescendo until its climax in the Romantic period, and its placement was now slightly later in the form. This is the main difference from the Shakespearean sonnet to the Petrarchan, the inclusion of a couplet at the end of the poem, offering a powerful conclusion and volta to the rest of the little song. Allow us to turn to this cup. Count the number of lines in Arby's column. There are 12 lines in the first 2 stanzas, split oddly into a quintain and a septet, certainly subverting the traditional Shakespearean style. Towards the end of the septet, there are 2 lines that serve as parallel structure that mark an interesting change in tone. That's who we are. That's what we do. With this tonality switch, one also feels a change in mood. Sure, the cup has offered its sense of pride, but with the evidence now given in previous lines of the cup, the parallel structure can be read with conviction. These 2 lines, then, serve as the cup's volta. It's certainly in the right position in the poem for it to make sense. Now look at the last stanza. If your food or experience did not delight, we would be happy to make it right. Did you hear that? It's a couplet that's been split into 4 lines. This technically pushes the line count to 16, a length made famous by Victorian sonneteer George Meredith in his sequence Modern Love, but still ends with a unique Shakespearean sign-off. Styled in the same way, the concluding couplet even has echoes to some of Shakespeare's plays. Listen to the mood in the epilogue to A Midsummer Night's Dream, delivered by Puck.
If we shadows have offended, think but this, and all is mended, that you have but slumbered here while these visions did appear, and this weak and idle theme, no more yielding, but to dream. Gentles, do not reprehend. If you pardon, we will mend. Else the puck a liar call. So good night unto you all. Give me your hands if we be friends, and Robin shall restore amends.
Now listen to the epilogue of The Tempest, delivered by Prosper. Notice how both dealt with a disclaimer to the audience apologizing for possibly offending those with the material contained within the play, begging the audience's forgiveness through their understanding that sometimes these faults do happen. Arby's couplet provides the same apology, albeit in a different and more contemporary meter. But here's a possibility of what Arby's couplet might sound like if it were in the famous iambic pentameter.
If food perchance did not thy taste delight, forgive us, pray, for we shall make it right.
In just 16 lines, Arby's has created a fascinating avant-garde approach to the old sonnet form, while still maintaining strong influences provided by the bard himself. While it may not have rhymed the whole way through, poems don't need to rhyme to be considered poetry. With its interesting quintain septet split and its couplet turned into a quatrain, Arby's may very well have created a new form of the sonnet. Perhaps this is the new face of the restaurant chain, harking back to our Elizabethan roots. Or maybe I'm wrong and it means nothing at all. Still, that doesn't mean I can't hope for future homages to other poets, so that way they can one day say, "Arby's, we have the Keats!" I hope you enjoy this excessive literary analysis of words written on a flimsy paper cup, and thanks for watching.